Okay, I want to welcome everybody. We're going to begin in about 2 minutes. Sound out of this. Okay. Okay, I want to welcome everybody to today's session on the appropriations and budget process. I'm glad everybody can join us today. The session is being recorded, so you can watch the session later if you want a recap of the program or to share this with other people who aren't able to join us right now. So today we're pleased to have a just deeper dive on appropriations and budget, and we're pleased to have with us today budget expert Aissa Canchola. Aissa is a budget expert from the consulting firm of Penn Hill Group, which ALA has had a relationship for a number of years. Some of you may have heard presentations from various Penn Hill experts in the past. Aissa brings to Penn Hill and ALA extensive experience in public policy, advocacy, organization, and coalition building. She previously worked as led outreach and strategy efforts for the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, focusing on student lending in higher education and consumer finance. She previously worked for a longtime library friend, Senator Patty Murray, on the Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee, often called the HELP Committee. Has played a key role in drafting the Every Student Succeeds Act and has worked on K-12 higher education and library policy. Prior to that, she worked with Senator Tom Harkin of Iowa, Barbara Boxer of California, and is a California native. So today, we want to welcome Aissa to join us, and we want to allow time for a Q&A at the during the session and particularly at the end of the session. So start thinking of your questions now, and why don't we just go ahead and begin. Aissa, welcome. And we're hearing a lot about appropriations and budget. It's a big topic these days, but there's not really one budget we're talking about. We're talking about multiple budgets. It gets a little confusing when we're talking about FY17, FY18, a CR, omnibus, skinny budget. Can you walk us through a little bit about the current budget status and what it all means for library funding?
Absolutely, and thank you so much for having me today. I'm really excited to engage in this conversation and really kind of take a deeper dive into the budget proposal and the appropriations process and what it means specifically for libraries across the country. So as you mentioned, Kevin, we are kind of in this weird period right now where we are, where Congress is actively considering the appropriations for FY 2017 and FY 2018. The government is currently funded under a continuing resolution, which is considered a CR, which people use written shorthand very frequently. This CR passed in December of 2016 and currently funds the government until April 28th of this year. So that deadline is right around the corner, which Congress is fully cognizant of. And there is a lot of conversation right now about whether or not Congress will pass an omnibus spending bill, which would essentially include smaller appropriations bills that would fund agencies across the government, or whether or not Congress will actually pass another CR, which would be a short-term continuing resolution that would ultimately fund the government for a few weeks more or for a certain amount of time. What we've been hearing on the Hill and from folks that we work very close with here in DC is that Congress is considering the passage of a short-term CR, which would allow the budget, allow the government to be funded beyond the April 28th deadline. We're not exactly sure how long that CR will be, but we do foresee some sort of a short-term CR, specifically because Congress, members of Congress are out on recess right now. So they're all visiting their districts or all home in their districts for the Easter recess. And by the time they come back, they'll only have about 4 legislative days to come up with what they're going to do to fund the government. So that is kind of giving the indication that there will be a short-term CR to keep the government funded for a short amount of time, at which point they will, hopefully, the hope is that they will pass kind of a broader omnibus bill again, that would fund the various agencies until the end of the 2017 budget year. What a lot of folks are actively talking about, and rightfully so, is the FY 2018 budget, which President Donald Trump's administration had recently, on March 16th, released their skinny budget, which is essentially a slimmed down version of the broader budget proposal that they would like to see funded for FY 2018. They have used the term skinny budget very frequently because it is very, very slimmed down, and it's a glimpse of what the administration would like to see funded and would like to see cut and eliminated in this next fiscal year. I believe I answered all of your questions. Am I missing anything? Sorry.
Well, there is another option, which is the dreaded government shutdown. Do you think that's to be taken seriously right now, or is that something that they're really going to, you think they're going to avoid that drastic step?
Well, it's definitely in the realm of possibilities. I think what a lot of folks have kind of felt more recently is that we really don't know what to expect. I think there are interests in both House and in the House and the Senate Appropriations Committees to pass either a short-term CR or an omnibus, but who knows what could happen. So the possibility of a shutdown, even if it is just for a couple of days, is definitely still possible. But I think we are all hoping for, you know, folks to kind of come together and cooler heads to prevail to see some sort of a larger omnibus pass in some way.
Thank you. So the when the president submitted his skinny budget, it was quite a dramatic event in Washington, landed quite loudly, and there were some very drastic cuts proposed in there. The elimination of many programs, including Library Services Technology Act and innovative approaches to literacy, which library community cares quite deeply about. How is that received? How does that affect the appropriations process in Congress?
Yeah, so the skinny budget definitely had included kind of across the board cuts, particularly the specific programs that you had mentioned, Kevin, and kind of holistically a $2.5 billion cut just to programs throughout the Department of Education. So pretty drastic cuts and program eliminations. I think from the meetings that we've had with folks on the Hill, I think there's really concerns on both sides, Republicans and Democrats alike, that this budget proposal is essentially, you know, just that, it's a proposal. And there have been some offices that have been even frank enough to say that it's dead on arrival. And I think that is to say, the reason being behind that is that a lot of these programs make a direct impact and a positive impact in the districts that these members represent. And they see the everyday positive impacts that these programs make. And that makes them far less likely to support a budget proposal or an appropriations bill that completely eliminates a program that that sustains jobs in their their district and in their local communities, that gives kids a safe place to go to after school while their parents are at work, you know, that provides ample funding to low-income schools and provides funding to low-income students to enter and succeed in college. So I think that there has been a lot of disappointment and outrage about this budget proposal from folks in Congress and from advocates across the country.
Yeah, we've been hearing we've been reading a little bit about the Office of Management and Budget Director has been suggesting that the president would like cuts in this year, the FY 17 budget, as much as about $2 billion from education alone. You know, we're hearing kind of pushback from Congress saying, you know, that we're just too far down the tracks on that. Are you hearing that or something different? Are they looking at cuts for this year?
With regards to FY 17, I think that There is a possibility for cuts. So with a clean CR, you would see, so a clean continuing resolution would essentially level fund all the programs for X amount of time. There have been talks of doing a CR with anomalies, which would mean that there would be some changes and some funding changes in particular. I think that is definitely a possibility. And I think that it's a real a reason for folks to really pick up the phone and contact our members of Congress to make sure that they know the value of, you know, of these programs, and to also stress that, you know, we're not out of the woods yet on FY17 and that we can't just focus on the budget cuts that are proposed in FY18.
All right, thank you. Let's talk a little bit about the Dear Appropriator letters that kind of kicks off the process in Congress. Mm-hmm. How important are these? How valuable are the Dear Appropriator letters, and are they taken seriously by the Appropriations Committees?
Definitely. So the Dear Appropriator letters, Dear Colleague letters, are really the opportunity for members of Congress to go on record supporting programs, supporting issues, and essentially making their plea to the Appropriations Committee through the number of signers that they can get on a letter. So there's some, you know, bipartisan letters that get, especially on the House side, hundreds of signatures, or you know, very, very many signatures. And especially also on the Senate side, it really is the opportunity to signal bipartisan support, significant support, bicameral support. So there have been some letters that get signers from both the House and the Senate that go to both Appropriations Committees that really stress that these programs pose value, they make a positive impact, and they have supporters in both chambers of Congress. And to answer your second question is the appropriators definitely take it very seriously, especially in the rare instance that an appropriator, a member that's on the Appropriations Committee, actually signs on to the appropriations letter. That also sends a really strong signal. But essentially what the appropriators do is they take all these letters and they prioritize them based on the number of signers they get, the bipartisan nature that they were able to get signers onto the issue and to the letter. But it is really, really important. And there are kind of letters on a vast array of issues that, you know, offices kind of get incoming on to get their boss to sign on. But it really is the opportunity to get your member on the record and in support of a particular program. And to be specific, the funding for a particular program.
Yeah, I mean, you may have heard this also, but, you know, I've had conversations with some congressional staff where they've talked about, you know, sometimes their boss will come in and say, you know, on the Appropriations Committee and say, okay, we need $100 million for NIH funding. You know, you, the staff need to figure out where to find this funding. And they've told us that sometimes they will take out these letters and say, okay, 25 people signed this letter for this program, 100 people signed this other letter. You know, it's going to be a little easier to cut the letter with 25 signatures because you're going to have fewer upset people for my boss to deal with. Then that's, you know, that is one of the reasons why these letters are so important.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I can't stress enough how tough of a job it is for these appropriation staffers who are essentially, you know, hammering out the specific numbers that go to particular programs. And when it comes down to it, when you have you know, hundreds of members of Congress, that's really kind of the easiest way to prioritize which programs get how much funding.
Sure, thank you. You know, we were very pleased this year. We, you know, since the President's skinny budget had proposed elimination of LSTA and innovative approaches to literacy, we felt it very, very important to increase the number of signatures on these letters. LSTA is, you know, some of the viewers may know, you know, it's a $155 million grant program to states where each state gets the funding. The state determines how to use the funding. There are no strings attached to it. Some of the programs, it funds veterans assistance programs in California, small business technology resources in North Carolina, library resources and books in Illinois, summer reading programs in Kentucky, statewide resources in Maine, and those are just a few of the examples of what LSTA does for the libraries. And Innovative Approaches to Literacy is a $27 million program. Half of that, or $13.5 million, is dedicated for school libraries and goes to provide literacy skills development for underserved neighborhoods. It provides books to children to bring them home, e-readers, training for teachers and parents. And we had a lot of success. We, you know, knew that getting, you know, increasing the signatures on the letters was very important. We began a campaign. We had our grassroots, our blogs, alerts, advisories. Our president, Julie Tadaro, convened a series of calls with chapters, divisions. We had calls with other segments of ALA, you know, stressing the point that it was so very important for the representatives in the House to sign these letters. We needed to increase the numbers. We worked with COSLA, other groups. Gail Sengage began a corporate campaign, Libraries Mean Business, to help increase awareness. We put together this website, Fight for Libraries. We had a number of calls, and the success was quite stunning in these letters. Last year, the LSTA Dear Appropriator letter had 88 signatures. It was led by Congressman Raul Grijalva of Arizona. We jumped that number to 144, thanks to the work of a lot of people watching today and a lot of other people. That was a 64% increase on that letter. It was bipartisan. We got, I believe, three Republicans on the letter. It's always helpful to be bipartisan. The Innovative Approaches to Literacy was led by four members, Eddie Bernice Johnson of Texas, Don Young from Alaska, Jim McGovern from Massachusetts, and Tom MacArthur from New Jersey. We increased the signatures there from 124 to 146, a 17% increase, so also bipartisan. So to increase these, both of these letters, quite a significant amount, I think was sent a strong signal that although the president may have proposed eliminating these programs, that, you know, there's very strong bipartisan support in Congress. And I'll just say that, you know, the Senate letters are going to begin circulating in a couple weeks. Those are not due until May 25th. The House letters were due last week. The Senate's deadline was a little bit different than the House. Senator Jack Reed is working most likely with Senator Susan Collins of Maine. Jack Reed of Rhode Island has always led these letters. Once these letters are dropped, we'll begin the campaign again in the Senate to get signatures. Last year, we had 34 on the LSTA letter, 31 senators on the IAL letter. We need to increase those numbers, and that we increased them quite a bit in the Senate. We need to increase in the House. We need to increase them in the Senate this year as well to send that message. So, you know, what else can, Aissa, let me ask you, you know, what else can done to, can members do to protect funding or to protect libraries going forward?
Yeah, I can't stress enough how important it is to pick up the phone and call your member of Congress, to call your senator. I know that it might seem as if that does not necessarily count, but the offices that get calls from their constituents they're keeping tabs. And you don't need to have an entire, you know, set of lines that you need to read off. It could be as easy as, my name is Aissa, I'm from your district, and I'm calling in support of the current letter that's going around to preserve funding for LSTA. And the person who's on the phone, the staff member, will jot it down, and those calls are logged every single day. The calls, the voicemails, and the emails. And that's the most direct way. One issue in particular, I remember just fairly recently, we had one person who had called in to their member of Congress and really kind of shared their personal story on the positive impact that a particular program showed. And that one constituent made the difference between that member signing on to a letter. And because they just really did a great job of just showing the real life impact that this program makes on their particular constituents in their district. I think when people look at numbers on a Excel doc and numbers on a ledger, it's very easy to forget or to discredit the actual human impact that those programs make. And so calling, writing an email, writing a letter, it really does help. I know that there are a lot of now more innovative ways to get in contact with your member as well, through social media, you know, through town halls a lot. As I mentioned earlier, it's Easter break, so folks are back in the district and are visiting their constituents and having town halls. That's a perfect time for you to head over to the town hall and stand up and say, what are you doing to protect funding for our local libraries? You know, this makes such a positive impact for my kids, or, you know, I work at a library. And, you know, it's such a great way to get your member to think about those issues right then and there.
Thank you. Yeah. You know, talk about some of the things that people can do. You know, town halls are important. I mean, they get kind of a bad publicity when people show up and start yelling. But, you know, do you feel that town halls are still a valuable opportunity to reach out to members?
Absolutely. I strongly suggest folks going to town halls. And I do know that right now there is a lot of issues that are driving very passionate people out to town halls. But I don't think that that should deter you from going and making sure that your voice is heard. I think there's also ways that you can, and so every member of Congress has a district office or several. Senators have offices throughout the state so that they're embedded within multiple parts of the community throughout the state. Those district offices are open to the public. You are more than welcome to walk in and make an appointment with your representative or your senator's field staff to make sure you know specifically what positive impact these programs are having to local communities around them. So there's always an opportunity. If you don't feel comfortable to go to a town hall, you can are always more than welcome to go to a field office. And all of that information is usually on your member of Congress's website as well.
What about, does it help to go with, you know, a couple peers, a couple other librarians who, you know, so they, you know, to go with friends and in force and have a couple people showing up and delivering the same message, you know, particularly at town hall, so they're not hearing from just one person, but multiple people? Does that help?
Power in numbers. Yeah, I think that would definitely help. And I also can't stress enough the importance of having personal stories. So if you work in a library and you have a group of students that you work closely with, you know, have those students write down their story and feel free to bring it with you to the meeting that you have, or drop it off at your field office, or send it into the DC office. A lot of the times, some of the most successful ways to get the story across is by sharing kind of the human impact. And a lot of the times that's really best done by showing, I mean, I used to work in education policy, so I still do, but I would always, you know, find the most convincing stories are when you can show how it impacted a particular student. And I think that that's also, you know, the same case here.
Yeah, I was in a Senate office, a House office last week from Maryland talking about appropriations, and where I was in there with an education group, and the staff person turned to me and asked me about, you know, what do libraries in Maryland get? How much funding do they get? And being able to have the numbers and the stories there to supply that to the staff member was very helpful. I mean, we're constantly trying to get people to send us the stories because that really helps us tell their story. And they hear from lobbyists all the time, but when they hear from folks back home and the stories back home, that is, that's what helps generate the support.
Absolutely.
And there are a few things that we stress for our members, a couple of the resources that we're happy to help with and provide. We want our members to know that we're about to begin the Dear Appropriator campaign in the Senate. As soon as those letters begin circulating, they're working on the final language right now and getting the original signatures on the letters. But once those begin circulating, we're going to let our members know that it's time to call their senators. So, you know, we encourage people to pay attention to when that campaign starts. We put together a website, Fight for Libraries. We encourage you to go there, share your stories with us. Those are very helpful. You know, we're encouraging people to, you know, particularly during the recess and throughout the year, invite members to come to the library, you know, take a tour of the library, see how some of the programs, particularly if they're LSTA programs or other federally supported programs, how important these are, and show them in action, show how they're working and meeting the needs of their community. Encourage people to sign up for district dispatch, write letters to the editor. We're happy to help with that. Members always want to know what's in their local newspapers back home. Their staff are constantly checking those. National Library Legislative Day is May 1st and 2nd. That's coming up. We encourage people to come in, bring your message to Washington. You'll be meeting with your representatives and senators there. If you can't make it, you know, virtual Library Legislative Day is another way you can participate as well. You know, are there other things that, libraries, librarians can do that, you can think of, Aissa?
I mean, I think you've touched on them a lot. I think that there are, I can't stress enough that there are so many other new innovative ways to get in contact with your member. You know, tweet them. It sounds so simple, but their staff are keeping track of that. And when, even if, you know, if you were to find out that your member, you know, did support the efforts and actually did sign on to the letter, tweet them and thank them. They really do appreciate that support. And so that, don't think that, you know, the only ways you can get involved are through kind of the calls and stuff like that. There are a lot of really social media focused efforts too.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. The, you know, one of the things that members often hear, particularly from members of Congress that are on the Appropriations Committee, that they don't sign letters. Few do, but most don't. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's still, you know, is it still important to say, give them the message, the Appropriations members, the message about the Dear Appropriator letters?
Absolutely. And to be honest, I think that one of the things that I've taken away from this appropriation cycle is that the budget proposal was so drastic and so extreme that some appropriators, if their district or their senator or their state is negatively impacted, they're signing on to appropriations letters. So don't assume that if they're on the Appropriations Committee that they won't sign. If you can show them that this is going to impact their state, I think that it's still fair game.
And I think Appropriations Committee members, they have a priority list. They put together a list of programs that they're on the top of their list, and they submit those to the committee. And you know, hearing from the librarian community helps raise their priority list and raise library funding to the top of those lists as well. Mm-hmm.
And that's another reason to particularly reach out to appropriators, folks that are on the Appropriations Committee, because the Appropriations Committee staff, they prioritize the committee members' priorities. That's one of the benefits of being on the Appropriations Committee. So if you're able to encourage and successfully get an appropriator to submit the program at the top of his or her priority list, that is definitely improves the support for the program.
All right, we've had our first question. I think you touched on it a little bit. You know, what is the most powerful thing a person can do if their representatives are already ironclad in their support for libraries?
I would thank them publicly, and then I would focus on ways that you can try to get. That's a really good question. So I would say thank them publicly. The second thing I would do is look at other members who might be kind of in a similar area or in a similar district, so particularly for House members. If there is one member of Congress who's in a district right next to one that didn't sign the letter, try to find ways that you can find data or find information, stories, and start targeting those members around that other members' district, because it's really, really important to stress that regionally there are interests that could really get members to kind of come together. And so if you have a very ardent supporter in one particular place, and it's likely because he or she has seen the impact in their district, it's very likely that the impact in a closely surrounding districts could also potentially move other members to do the same.
What, you know, as a former staff member, you're constantly considering a lot of very good programs and a lot of very effective and valuable programs. And you're trying to, people are coming to you as a staff member to raise the profile on a particular issue. And it's not that we don't want these other programs funded. They're also very important, but, you know, what, as a staff member, you know, resonated with you when somebody would come and say, you know, this is why this program, you know, what raises the profile of an issue for you as a former staff member?
As a, you know, putting my former staffer hat on, I think the number one thing is the direct impact in the district or in the state. the positive impact, the positive outcomes that come from the program really do come first and foremost. I think most recently, especially with kind of a lot of the conversations going on around, wanting to prioritize funding for programs that have strong evidence base. I think that that's something that is going to be a huge priority for folks. It has been for a while, but I think now more so than ever, especially with some of the remarks made by the OMB director wanting to stress that only programs that have a strong evidence base and that encourage evidence-based practices will be funded. I think that that's something that will definitely become more common in those conversations as well.
All right, thank you. Let me encourage folks to, submit questions. We're happy to answer your questions. This is why we're having a session here. Let me ask, there's all sorts of social media out there. What are the more effective social media advocacy tools that you've seen?
So I've seen a lot of really great, really big groups take advantage of Twitter town halls. Those tend to be a really great way to get the word out to a broader coalition. So if you have a broad coalition working together to get things to start trending, to have it affiliated also with a media strategy to get press to elevate that messaging, a lot of members and their offices take part in Twitter town halls. And I think that those are some of the most easiest ways because everybody's just gets on Twitter for an hour in the day and starts, really getting into that conversation. And it's another way of getting members on the record, even though it's on Twitter, but it really does make a difference, I think, now more so than ever. But I think Twitter is a great resource. I think you see members trying to utilize so many different things. So Facebook, even Instagram, there's like ways to now reach out to your member of Congress on Instagram and to invite them. If you post a picture of one of your great events at a local library, tag your member of Congress and say, hey, we would love to have you next time. I think that's also a really innovative way to get on their radar. Chances are their communications director or some members actually run their own Instagram and Twitter accounts, or their communications director will flag it for the member and make sure that they know about it.
Okay. Thank you. What would you say we have, some people come and they're a little intimidated by coming to Washington and meeting with staff, particularly maybe younger folks. What would you say to them to encourage them to still, come to Washington and make the pitch and reach out to your members and not be intimidated? What could you say to those folks?
I would just stress so much that you are the expert. You are the expert in, best how this money is making a difference in your community way more than the staffer does. It's obviously our job to serve our bosses in the best way we can, former staffer hat on, but when a constituent comes in, they are top priority and they know, to be honest, the staffers love it when constituents come in over lobbyists, to be quite honest. And you have the highest potential to make that direct impact because you're coming directly from the boss's district or from the state and actually have the ability to get, your boss reelected. So I would definitely not discredit the impact that constituents can make on Hill days, reaching out to have a meeting. And I know that it's very intimidating, but once you get there, you realize that your staffers are just people and they're just trying to do their job and trying to craft positive policy. And that's essentially what you're going to the Hill to do as well, is try to stress and encourage them to pass policy that does well by your community.
Let me ask kind of a follow-up. When they come to Washington and meet with the staff and, they'll have the meeting or go to the town hall, what would you suggest for people to do as a follow-up after those meetings to keep that line of communication going, to build that relationship?
Definitely. So what I would say is, first, when you come to your meeting, come prepared with numbers, come prepared with stories. The last thing you want to do is go to a staff member and have a meeting, and then they say, well, how much money has the district received from this program since it was authorized? And you just blank. I think that that's one of the, like, just you want to always be prepared for the particular questions that you might get, especially on funding levels or the direct impact. And then use the follow-up, you know, feel free to reach out to them via email a day or two later or even the next week, and just say, you know, that you appreciated having the conversation, and make sure to reaffirm and send them the data and the numbers and the written stories, because I've used to do this all the time for Senator Murray. I would get stories via email from folks, and I would pass them along to our communications team. And Senator Murray was very passionate about sharing stories from her constituents. And she would share them on the Senate floor very, very often. And I know that that's something that's very common. So definitely follow up with kind of the information, the leave behinds that you might leave in print, send the digital copies as well so that they can keep track of them, and they could include in their boss's binders that they take home at the end of the night so that they could read it. It really is a good way to maintain that relationship. And then once you have that line of communication and things start moving, this, who knows, a staffer might reach out to you and say, hey, I need additional stories, or hey, are there updated numbers, which could really help you build that relationship with the office.
Thank you. We have another question. Are there any specific programs that are at risk due to the upcoming budget decisions? I mean, are there, you know, particular programs or areas that you really, you think?
Yeah. I think some of the biggest, at least within the education space, the budget proposal had recommended the elimination of the 21st Century Community Learning Centers program, which is the federal funding that supports after school programs across the country. That was a drastic, quite dramatic elimination of a program. There are huge, you know, coalitions across the country. I think there's particular language there that also allows for the partnership with libraries. There is like a library component to some of those activities too. I think additionally, within the K-12 education space in particular, the Title II program, which is the professional development program that goes to about 97% of school districts across the country. You know, they receive this funding to provide high quality professional development for teachers, for educators, for school leaders. There is a direct component there that impacts libraries as well. There's language in the program that allows for activities in partnership with libraries. So that's also a particular program that was eliminated. The Corporation for National and Community Service, which, you know, obviously puts volunteers kind of across the country in areas of high need. That entity was eliminated within the budget proposal. And that's just, you know, within the education space. I know that there's a variety of job training programs. There are a lot of programs that were proposed to be eliminated. But I can't stress enough that this is something that should not be, It should almost feel kind of like that fire that ignites you to like get involved in this process, because Congress holds the purse strings for the government. And granted, the president will need to sign any type of appropriations bill. However, the power of the purse belongs to Congress. So, those are the people who are directly connected to you. So make sure to, pick up the phone and call and make sure that your voice is heard.
Does it help to, and let me encourage folks to, you know, send us more messages or more questions, but do you find it's helpful or you know, maybe it's just too obvious, but to tailor your message depending on who, if you're talking to a Republican or a Democrat, I mean, you can go in and talk about all sorts of different programs, but, you know, is there value in going into Republican offices and talk about some of the business services or veteran services that LSTA supports, is that worth doing to tailor depending on which office you're going into?
I absolutely I completely agree. I think that there are, I mean, do your research. If you are going to reach out to your member of Congress and you know that he or she is a veteran, make sure to have your talking points tailored to the way in which your library serves veterans in the community. If your member of Congress is a former small business owner, talk about the positive impacts to the economy, to you know, spurring small business growth or spurring investments in the local community. Tailor your message to those particular issues. If your member of Congress was a school teacher, I think that that's also something that you should have your research ready, because that definitely will impact the way that you craft your talking points and essentially craft your pitch to your member's office.
One of the things that we've been working on is reauthorization of LSTA, which expired at the end of last year. And we hear some members, particularly in the House, some more conservative members, saying that unauthorized programs might not, maybe they shouldn't be funded. And how would you address that question? I mean, there are a lot of programs, NIH is, I understand, not authorized, but, you know, if you our members walk into an office and say, well, you're not even authorized, how would you respond to that question?
I think that I don't think you should be discouraged by that question. I think that you should, if Congress was, adamant about reauthorizing bills before they expired, then perhaps. But I think that you could point to past appropriations levels. And while the program might have expired in terms of its authorization, if appropriators are still funding it, that shows that there is a bipartisan support in Congress to continue this program. I wouldn't be discouraged by that program or by that question.
Thank you. Yeah, and I should preface that by saying that is one of our priorities this year, is to get reauthorization for LSTA. Mm-hmm. Let me encourage, we've been talking for almost 45 minutes now. If folks do have questions, we're happy to answer those. Is there anything that, can you talk a little bit about what reauthorization means? What is an authorized versus an unauthorized program?
So an authorization essentially is the language, the bill that Congress passes that allows appropriators to fund a program. There have been some programs that are funded through appropriations language, which essentially is the appropriators come together and say, this program is important to us and we're going to fund it. There are authorizing committees in Congress. The HELP committee, of which that I used to work for, was an authorizing committee, and they craft the policy. So the authorization process, the reauthorization process, really allows the opportunity for Congress to re-look at programs and look at ways that it's working or maybe that it's not working, ways that they could modernize it. For instance, the most recent, really significant reauthorization within the education space was the reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, which was reauthorized in 2015 through the passage of the Every Student Succeeds Act. And that program or that bill was in need of reauthorization for, I think, almost since 7 years. So it was like 7 years past its expiration. However, because all the programs were top priority, appropriators continued to fund it. I will say that it does take a while for things to be reauthorized, because essentially you're recrafting the policy and your words matter. So, changing particular parts of a program could mean the difference between folks continuing to get funding and activities continuing to get kept funding from the federal government. So it's not something that happens very frequently. But that being the case, when it does happen, it's very, very monumental, and it's an opportunity for stakeholders like librarians to engage and make sure that the bill is crafted in a way that benefits the work that you all do in your community every day.
All right, thank you. Ask for questions. Is there anything for folks to know, or is it too much in the weeds to talk about sequestration or any sort of the finer points of appropriations that it could affect funding levels?
I think that this sequestration is definitely something that we should be concerned about. I think that there just is not enough information out about what's going to be in the appropriations bills that will trigger sequester. I think that that's what happens when Congress puts together budget caps, and when things are within, when things go below those budget caps, folks have to do across the board cuts, which essentially leads to sequestration. I think we just don't know enough at this point on whether or not that's going to be an issue right now.
All right, thank you. Is there anything that's been a surprise for you in the president's skinny budget, other than how stark it was? Do you think the administration, you know, is really understanding the value of education, or are they really under support? I mean, we know they're under supporting, but do you think there's a, you know, fundamental lack of understanding of the value of education? I mean, it's not something you can point to and say it's, you know, sometimes it's very difficult to show the value of a program when the value really is going to come, you know, 10 years from now, when you have a more educated student population are applying for, you know, better jobs and more qualified to serve in the military. But the value of that started 10 years ago.
Yeah. I mean, I think one of the most disappointing things about the budget, and I think that I always tell folks that the budget is, when Congress votes on a budget and votes on an appropriations bill, it essentially lists out our priorities as a country. And I think, unfortunately, this budget proposal definitely makes a huge hit and an impact on the programs that are funded through the Department of Education or are related to education. And you see a very significant shift from education programs, domestic programs, to ultimately defense spending and to, particular priorities that this administration had set out in stone throughout the campaign. That being said, I think that we will get a better understanding of the broader budget proposal when President Trump releases the broader budget in the middle of May. I don't foresee the budget getting any better, though. I think that we actually anticipate more cuts. But with that being said, I think that we just need to keep in mind that it is a budget proposal. It's not something set in stone, and that Congress is the one who makes the decisions on the funding levels. So, I mean, I think it is definitely disappointing to have seen kind of the programs that were eliminated, particularly, you know, some of the smaller ones that are making such a big difference in the community, and are definitely not the make or break spending programs that, you know, obviously are driving the deficit. But I think that, you know, this was just the first glimpse, so we just need to be prepared for when the final budget comes out, and use that as a mobilizing mechanism to, you know, preserve funding for libraries and show the importance of what you all do every day.
All right, let me ask you to kind of gaze into your crystal ball and, you know, kind of project out what you see happening in the heading into the fall. You know, how stark do you think the FY18 budget is going to be? Are there going to be dramatic cuts? Are we looking at a series of CRs, shutdown? I mean, what are you expecting to see as we head into the fall?
I think this is very, I think it, right now, I would say that there will probably be, a short-term CR that will kind of give them a little bit more time, and then a broader omnibus bill. I think that it is very likely that we will see cuts this year, especially just considering, I think that folks are going to want to try to show that they're meeting the president's kind of halfway somewhere. I think that there will likely be cuts. I don't think they will be super steep. But I think within the broader FY18 budget trajectory, I do anticipate significantly more cuts. when we mentioned that the skinny budget was a very slimmed down version of the budget, the Department of Education's budget proposal, I think, was like 2 pages, and the majority of the programs that are funded through the Department of Ed were not even listed. So we still have no idea what particular programs will be on the chopping block still. I have been in meetings where folks have said, if you're not, you know, related to DOD, everything is on the table. I think that is obviously disappointing to hear, but I think that kind of gives us an indication of how potentially worse it could get. But I think, again, right now we stand at a really critical moment as Dear Appropriator letters are going around and as folks are deciding whether or not to sign on to these letters, you know, the importance of showing bipartisan, bicameral support for these programs on the front end, as opposed to once the budget's out and everybody is kind of frantic and trying to, you know, get advocacy efforts on the ground.
Are you hearing any timetable on when a more fuller, robust budget might be coming from the administration?
So we have heard the second week of May. So second or the middle of May will be the day for the big budget.
So there could be more cuts coming.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a question. How likely is it that the dynamic we saw during the Affordable Care Act replacement bill will play out in the budget process, i.e. The Freedom Caucus calls for a draconian bill versus moderate and the public blowback from that bulks on that process? And, you know, how do you see that playing out? So the division within the Republican Party.
Yeah, I think that's very, very possible. I don't know how far ahead they had anticipated what had happened with the ACA replacement effort. But I think that's a very real possibility. I think if there is a split within the Republican Party, I think that actually increases the likelihood of a potential shutdown, because the more you have folks trying to bring this proposal to the right, the less likely you are to get moderate Democrats and Democrats to sign on to any type of spending bill. So I think we should be very wary. If that does happen, I don't think that it'll be for the positive.
Do you think a budget is possible without Democratic votes? Can the Republicans pull enough votes together on their side, or is that really not going to be possible?
Well, I think for appropriations, they really do need Democrats, because they know that there are going to be some folks on the right that are just not going to support. So I think that that's why the hope is that cooler heads will prevail and that we'll be able to get something that both Dems and Rs can support.
All right. Oh, I want to thank you. We're coming up on almost 55 minutes here, so I don't see any further questions. Is there any final message that you would want to leave with our members today, and we'll wrap up the session today?
Yeah, definitely. I know I've said this several times throughout this this session, but I really do think that the time is now to get involved, to make sure that your voice is being heard, both in the district as your members of Congress are back home, and even while they're back in Congress. Even if you wanted to call your member of Congress's office today and know that he or she is not in the office, their staff will keep logs of who calls on what issue and pro or against. So that really does matter. And I can't stress that the time is now to get involved before, long before the broader budget gets released. So I would just really encourage you all to utilize your great ALA staff and, you know, utilize a lot of the platforms that they've set up online, and, you know, really take advantage of that and make sure folks hear from you loud and clear.
All right. Well, thank you. I want to thank you, Aissa, for joining us today. Thanks the people for submitting questions. Just want to remind folks, you know, check out Fight for Libraries, sign up, get engaged, come to Library Legislative Day. And, you know, watch out for the Senate Dear Appropriator campaign. Should be kicking off in another week or so. And I want to thank everybody for joining. And again, we're going to post this discussion today. And I want to thank everybody for joining us. With that, we will sign off. Thank you.